we invite Professor Gross to give us the closing remark.
Okay, yeah, we have had a wonderful meeting, lots of new developments and super interesting results. And when he did this mean thing and asked me to say something at the end, and what makes it worse is that I'm not really an expert in this field. So I'd rather call this views from an outsider. And so some of the people on the first day were saying, so we discover more and more topologies, more and more materials, and there's kind of a big table where we list all the possibilities. And here I want to come back to this recent work that in a sense all possible band structure topologies have been classified. So this is this work by Andre Gernevik and his group in Princeton. So they took all the 230 space groups, constructed the high energy, high symmetry points, and then used a graph theory to construct the possible connections, and including time reversal symmetry, they ultimately found, in this sense, all possible band structures, all possible band structures from the topological point of view. Now, it's not quite all possibilities yet, because magnetic groups were not studied yet, and this is what I understand they are currently doing. But then, once this is done, in a way, all possibilities have been found, right? So, I was once discussing with Andre Gernevik, well, you finished the field, I will say, right? It's, are we done? And, of course, not at all. I would rather say, this is really the beginning. So, because once we have all possible topologies, what still needs to be worked out are the physical properties of these possible topologies, in particular response function. And I'm sure we will find all kinds of interesting features in these topologies. But more importantly, I would say we actually have to find materials for each of these possible topological band structures, right? And above all, experimentally, right? And this is largely based on experimental intuition, but also, I think, an important role will play computational materials design, right? So there's this number of first steps were presented by Christian. So we have nowadays structure prediction methods there of various kinds, so we can, in a sense, search the space of all possible materials, and if we require a certain descriptors, the materials not only to be stable but also to have certain properties, we can in this way find particular materials with these properties. Now, it was emphasized in Professor Castroneto's talk, we know now something like a few hundred 2D, strictly 2D materials. This exfoliation is possible for those, and there will probably be many more. And as Christian emphasized, well, when you combine those to make heterostructures, there's millions of possibilities. And as we saw in the last talk, if we add strain and similar things, it's an infinity of possibilities, really. And this is to be explored, and I'm sure there's a lot of especially in this field of nanostructures, a lot of interesting features to be found. So I would rather say this is the beginning. Now, on the theoretical side, so far, most of the theoretical work or computational work has used Cohn-Chahn density functional theory. Now, this is of course not really the final answer, right? And I would say there are two distinct problems. They're really different from each other. And one thing is, as you use density functional theory, you have to use some approximation here for the exchange correlation potential. LDA, GTAs, and we have now better functionals. And one question is, to which extent does actually the predicted topology and other features depend on the functionality you have used? Probably for topological features, not so extremely important, right? So details maybe will differ if you use a different functional, so bands will be bent or so. Topology is more robust, except perhaps for this well-known problem that simple functionals like LDA and GTA tend to predict a too small gap. And then if it's really too small, there's no gap at all anymore. Then clearly you have a problem. And now this can be solved using GW. We have seen these beautiful examples in Christian's talk. But you have to remember, and I want to emphasize that, that also Green's function theory is a functional theory. And so in a sense, it's very similar to density function theory. You need to find an approximation for the exchange correlation. Self-energy as a functional of the Green's function. So it's a Green's function functional theory. And for charge degrees of freedom, charge excitations, excitons, and so on, GW does a marvelous job. It's really the gold standard. But for magnetic properties, it's actually quite bad. So things, predictions of the, even the magnetization field as functional bar is in many cases terrible. So for certain things also GW is not the ultimate answer. So there remains to be some work to be done. Now, another problem is, even if we imagine we have the exact functional of DFT, let's say, right, so we get then something for a given material, we would get the exact Cohn-Chahn orbitals. And from the variphase expressions, we could then calculate, let's say, the macroscopic polarization or topological invariance. We are still not guaranteed that this would be the true answer for the interacting system. Right? In nature, we have interactions. All systems are really interacting. And we have learned from DFT that the Cohn-Chahn system is only tailored to give you the right density, right? And the right total energy. And so if you had the exact functional, you would get the exact density and the exact energy. But other quantities that you calculate from the Cohn-Chahn determinants, right, are not necessarily the right ones. So, what can we do? Can we check this somehow? And indeed, that's possible, at least for the macroscopic polarization, and all I'm going to say now in the coming seconds really refers to the macroscopic polarization. This can be written down, and has been written down in this paper a long time ago, in terms of the many-body wave function. So a many-body wave function of a periodic system, where it satisfies these twisted boundary conditions. In terms of this wave function, one can define what the macroscopic polarization is. Right? So we know the true answer, at least in this case. Now, knowing the true answer means that then, in principle, one could, using the Hohenbeck-Ohm theorem, rewrite this as a functional of the density, a functional of the Hohenstamm orbitals. Right? Now, to write these things, quantities other than the energy and the density in terms of the Hohenstamm orbitals, that history of the last 30 years has taught us is very difficult. But maybe it's easier if we can approximate this quantity in terms of the Green's function, or maybe in terms of the one-body density matrix. And in fact, in a sense, this has been achieved, and this is a recent paper that we haven't published yet, but it's on the archive. It's this one, where we represent the exact expression in terms of the many-body wave function approximately in terms of the natural orbitals and the occupation numbers of the one-body density matrix. Right, so there is, in fact, and it's extremely accurate, so deviations are per mil. So it's so in this particular case, at least, it's possible. And but there's other cases, other topological invariants, and so on. And much more work to be done. Now, what I would say is the ultimate challenge is to do all what I have said before, but at finite temperature. So we would really be able to predict, let's say, topological phase transitions, temperature driven, maybe, and we would really be able to, like to be able to, make predictions of things like the critical temperature. So this is my outsider view of some aspects of this field. And well, I hope there will be future conferences, NCTS type, on similar topics. So I must say, this was a wonderful meeting, lots of interesting things. And I would like to finish thanking the organizers, particularly one here, and the others for putting together this wonderful program. So, thank you.
Thank you, Professor Gross, a nice closing remark. So, I think, as Professor Gross said, successful conference, we need to have a very a lot of people to put together. So first, I think we'd like to thank all the speakers who give a nice talk over the 3 days. So let's thank all the speakers again. And also the audience play a very important role in the discussion section. So we also give ourselves a pause, say we did a good job in the participation of this conference, all right? And finally, our conference need a very wonderful staff to help to organize the itinerary of all the speakers, all the participants, as lunch and all the reimbursement of money, of course, very important issue. So let's send our staff is stand behind me. So let's appreciate Alice. She is email everyone for all the information and all the direction for the conference. So I think that's end of this session. So maybe Professor Guo,
no, you are the co-chair.
Oh, co-chair. All right. So we have a lunch bus outside. So if you feel you want to stay longer around this conference room to discuss more, I think it should be okay. I think we reserve the room here afternoon, so it should be okay. All right, so have a nice trip back home, or enjoy your trip, rest of the day in Taiwan. Okay, thank you.